interesting to see see real LA.
That's true.
Rather than the fake LA that most of the film industry is based in, this kind of weird cocoon.
Well, there are multiple LAs. Werner Herzog actually says this is the greatest cultural city in the world.
Yeah, but don't believe everything he says.
I don't believe anything he says,
exactly.
Actually.
Exactly.
He's one of the great liars of all
time.
He's
a genius.
He is.
He's just brilliant. He's created this amazing persona.
Yes.
Which is absolute bullshit.
Being full of shit is his best thing.
He's very good at it. He's like the most interesting character in all of his recent films.
Documentary an early love of yours, or is it something, because you seem to have come to it in terms of your bio a little late.
Yes. I mean, my first short film was a documentary, that pizzeria guy in South Wales. Now, I've made short documentaries at film school, and I've worked in TV where there's lots of quick turnaround and doing things like that. Mm-hmm. But my interest in filmmaking was always more in drama. So this is the first time where a subject came along, and the project was brought to me as a documentary, and I just thought, okay, this would be interesting to try out, mm-hmm. particularly because of all of the elements. You know, it's about a real person, it's about a sporting character, there's a lot of footage that already exists. It seemed natural that was the way to do it.
So how did they came to you with a lot of things intact?
The project had already been set up. The producer, James Gay Reese, had the idea to make the film. Uh-huh. He approached Working Title. James's father used to know Senna and work with him when he drove the black car, the Lotus. Mm-hmm. So he used to come home from work saying, this guy's just unreal. I've met someone who's not like any other person I've ever met. He's the most charismatic, most intense, most focused young man. And James wasn't really a Formula One guy. He was more of a soccer guy. So he kind of heard it, but he wasn't necessarily something that meant anything at the time. It was only 10 years after his accident in 2004 when the Times of London printed this article about Senna, and the language that the journalist was using was the same language that his father used to use. So that's when something clicked, and by now James was a producer, he'd made fiction films. So he went to Working Title and spoke to the executives there and said, I'd like to make a film about Senna, but as a documentary, would you be interested? And there were lots of stages in our film of luck that kind of happened.
And Working Title had never made a documentary.
Universal never made a documentary. James had never made a documentary. He talks to them. The woman that he's talking to, the executive, says, you've got to meet my husband. He's the world's biggest Senna fan. And that's Manish Pandey, who's the writer, who's seen every race, read every book, has the amazing kind of detail for knowledge. He's a surgeon. This is his first film of any form, so he's never made a documentary. They then approached the family to get the permission to make the film, and the family approve it because Manish is such a fan. He was able to tell them the way the story could work. And in a way, lots of people in the past had asked about making a film, but they were really going to focus on Imola, on the accident, on the weekend, the cursed weekend.
And which Manish is what Herzog would have done.
Which is maybe what other filmmakers would do, whereas Manish wanted to make the film about his life. Mm-hmm. Then they approached Bernie Eccleston, who owns the commercial rights to the footage. He owns all of the material. Only once they had all of these kind of pieces in place did they look for directors. And there were lots of obvious kind of documentary directors that they approached, who, thank God, were all busy. And so then it came to me.
So is Eccleston kind of a mad genius, thinking that he should get these rights? I mean, who knew this would have the value?
He's a very good businessman. He was in Formula One already. He used to run a team back in the day. And he'd won world championships and things like that. So he's a very clever guy, and he realized that the future was in kind of marketing of the product, was really where it was. Running a team or running a track or having a driver was kind of too small for him.
So he owns the television footage as well?
He owns the commercial rights for the sport, which means if anyone wants to show the sport on TV, they've got to talk to him and pay for it.
That's kind of breathtaking.
Yeah. Yeah. So therefore, anything within the confines of a track, essentially from Senna's era onwards, anything photographed, sound, anything within the confines of a track, he owns. So if you want to make a film to do with Formula One, and you want any archive footage, you've got to go to him.
And it continues to this day?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. So you come in.
Yeah.
They find you.
Yes.
How far along are they in terms of picking things, writing things?
Manish had written an outline. It's like a 10-page outline of the kind of golden age, this particular decade. But within that, there were lots of other drivers. There were two other world champions, Nelson Piquet and Nigel Mansell. It was a much bigger idea. Mm-hmm. And so what really happened over the next few years was really with Manish, James and myself, to try and work out, well, this story's too big, we're going to have to eliminate elements, right. You know, it's a process of elimination, and let's take something out. And we ended up focusing on Senna and Prost, which was the key rivalry, which was, you know, like Ali Frazier, Borg Macro, that kind of right. Two opposite styles, two geniuses at what they do, but very different characters, very different technically how they do what they do, at the same time in the sport, coming head to head.
And was the bigger idea that he'd had before a just a broader picture of the sport, or was there a conceptual
idea? It was more of a kind of a broader picture of the sport, but focusing on Senna. But right. At the time, it was more conventionally set up as a 40 minutes of archive, 40 minutes of talking heads, 10 minutes miscellaneous material. So that was how it was budgeted when I came on board. And that's what I thought we would be doing. I thought right. we'd be doing interviews and, you know, it'd be a mixture of footage. Mm. It was only as we were doing the research and as I was looking at footage, I had an edit suite. The classic thing that happens on a movie is you agree to make a movie and then it's months before anyone gets paid,
right.
You know, because you're waiting for contracts to sort themselves out. And there are a few heavyweight people involved in this film. So it took 8 months. So I was not able to hire an editor, but I had 8 months to look at footage on YouTube. And that's when the idea came about, well, I don't think we need to shoot talking head interviews. I don't think we need to see them. Mm-hmm. We may well do research. We may well talk to people and hear their voices, but actually it's all there. The rushes, the dailies are so amazing. I don't know if there's anything I could shoot that would improve what's already in existence. And also you're in the moment, the tension, the drama of being in the moment, living with Senna and having Senna narrating the film rather than someone now looking back with kind of rose-tinted glasses and saying, oh, he was great, he was the fastest. When actually, mm-hmm. at the time, there was this amazing bitter rivalry, which is much more dramatic, much more of a movie.
And you were comfortable that you had enough footage to cover?
My gut instinct was it was all there. I mean, we're making a film which is essentially the length of one race. But, you know, he had 18 races a season for 10 years. And you're being interviewed before, during, and after the race. And then you've got Brazilian TV following you everywhere you move. You've got Japanese TV following you everywhere you move. So there was thousands of hours of material.
And again, this guy controls the Japanese TV rights to that material?
No, only whatever happens within the track.
Okay.
So if a Japanese cameraman comes from Fuji TV and shoots at a race, Bernie Eccleston owns it. If a Brazilian TV channel, if ESPN, anyone who comes from abroad, he owns it. But if you shoot something away from the track, then they own it. So that's how I mean, we're working this all out as we were going along.
So did you find this footage by looking on YouTube or by figuring
initially,
somebody
out? We started off on YouTube. We cut a short film that came purely from YouTube material, which is 12 minutes long, and to show this is how the movie could work.
Right.
And that's how we got greenlit by Working Title and by Universal. Afterwards, we were able to access archives in Fuji's archives in Japan, Globo's archives in Brazil. We had a researcher in São Paulo, in Rio, in France, in Paris, in Rome, and we ourselves went into Bernie Eccleston's archive, which no one's ever been in before, and we had access for a few weeks, and so we would be there day after day just forwarding through material until something amazing would come up.
Because I do think that the defining characteristic of the film is that it feels like a film and not like a documentary.
Yeah, I mean, because I'm a drama director, my feeling was we could play this as a drama. It works in a very classical three-act structure, you know, as a beginning, the rise of the character, this guy coming in, the outsider, the middle, which is a rivalry, and then this cursed weekend, which is the final act.
Mm-hmm. Do you think this that using found footage, I guess, essentially, is the entirety of your dramatic visual is and narrative, really, is something that will affect how you direct feature films going forward?
I think every movie you make, you learn something, and it affects the next one and the next one. I think in this particular case, there's something about Senna which made it possible to make this film this way. It's something special about him. You know, he was followed by Globo everywhere he went before he got into Formula One. Once in Formula One, you know, he became big in Japan because he drove a car with a Honda engine. So they loved him. And he became like their kind of honorary samurai for the Japanese. So they followed him everywhere he went. And also a lot of the key races climaxed in Japan. So there was always footage in Brazil, Brazil and in Japan. And then he existed in a sport which, without TV, you don't know what's going on. You can go to a track, you can't see anything, you can't hear anything. So you have to watch it on TV. That's the genius of it. And it's free to air all over the world. So, you know, it's something about him at this particular moment in time before YouTube, before Twitter, before Facebook, where he could say what he really thought on camera and it wasn't an issue. He was a man's man. As with Prost would say what he really felt to a French journalist.
Right.
And it was all on the record. And it was all on camera. It was all on tape. Then on top of it, you know, Senna, when he drives, there's a camera on his shoulder. So when he goes to work, there's a camera there. And it's just something unique about him, the sport he was in, and a particular moment in time that enabled us, you know, before public relations kicked in, before people said, no, he didn't say that's off the record, you know. This was all, whatever I say, it's on the record. I don't mind.
In a weird way, it's almost like the reason we don't have stars the way we used to have stars, maybe because they're so managed at this point.
Yeah, exactly. Something's changed. You know, the way people it's all, you know, it's impossible for someone to say something without knowing who they're saying it to.
Right.
Whereas at this time, you know, the driver's briefings, for example, this amazing footage where he's arguing with the guy who runs the sport, Jean-Marie Balestre, that the cameraman is there, but that cameraman is someone who's part of the sport, so mm-hmm. they're trusted. So they're ignoring the camera. And the cameraman's just doing it purely for their love of their work. You know, mm-hmm. no one's ever going to see this. You know, I personally would have had a wide shot and left it. But they know right. when to go in for a close-up, when to whip pan across to get a reaction shot, when to zoom out. It's just amazing camera work.
And did those cameramen had no motive or any
particular thing they were shooting for? They work for Bernie Eccleston. They work for FOM, which is the people who basically run the sport. They're not journalists coming in who have right. special access to a meeting. So therefore, that's just footage that maybe one day will end up on an end of season review show. Uh-huh. But it probably doesn't. You know, no one would see it.
So how much footage did he shoot that has never been seen before? I mean,
he's got an aircraft hangar full of tapes. You know, we looked at about 15,000 hours of material, mm. and our Avid had about 5,000 hours of material. So it was a major slog. We had, you know, the researchers did a lot of work, and what would happen is we'd have a story beat that we wanted. Instead of conventionally going out and shooting it, we'd have to ask everyone, find something a bit like this around this time of year in mm-hmm. this season, featuring these characters, and then they'd send material back. And often we'd have, you know, a shot would come in from Brazil, another shot would come in from Japan, we'd find something in an archive in Paris and another shot in London, mm. and we'd cut them together and we'd have a scene. So it wasn't as simple as each scene came from an archive in one particular country. Literally, right. shot from shot to shot, we're cutting from a different country's camera angle, if you saw, to construct it like a drama. Right. So we could have a shot, a reverse, a two-shot, a helicopter shot, and cut it like a drama.
Right.
So, for example, when he wins in Brazil, and he's struggling to raise the trophy when he wins at home for the first mm-hmm. time. That footage has been taken from all over the world to construct one scene.
Mm. So what was the hard? Was that the hardest one, or were there harder?
That is one of my favorite ones. I don't know if it's the hardest one. I think the earlier we are in the film, the more difficult it is, because there's less cameras.
Right.
As we're going along, not only are our characters getting older, but and the cars are getting more and more modern and technology comes into it, but the cameras are improving. So as we go along, the footage improves and there's more cameras on the track.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time we get to Imola, which is the climax of the film, you know, there's probably about 30 cameras following every single movement Senna mm-hmm. makes. Everywhere he goes, there's 30 cameras. So I had so many choices to go from, you know. The more difficult sequences were at the beginning, where I may only have two or three angles. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want to use the image that was always shown on TV. Every single race, every single moment, I was trying to go back to the dailies to construct it as a movie rather than the classic right. kind of TV feed.
And what about his personal life? Was that harder than the footage? Or?
Oh, you know, my rule was always, if I can show it, it's going to be in the movie. Uh-huh. What I didn't want to do is make a film with kind of other people's opinions about Senna. And so, obviously, if his girlfriends were featuring in footage, then we could show them. If there's something that's going on in behind private, kind of
right.
in a hotel room, then that's not for me. There's plenty of gossip kind of documentaries that we made in Brazil. So we tried to show what his family meant to him, what Brazil meant to him, and his serious relationships. But essentially, he had a series of relationships. He never really found the right one.
Right.
He never really settled down. And that was just the nature of it. He was so obsessed with what he did that everything was sacrificed in order for him to follow his dream and to go as fast as he possibly could always.
Well, it didn't sound like from the film that he really was looking for that mate.
No, I think towards the ending, there's a particular interview that it gives him. Are we have to carry on with this?
The
sound?
Engine's going now. We're revving down the track. Go on.
Yeah. 1992, he gives an interview, which is in a film, where he says, I can't
welcome
talk
to Los Angeles.
I can talk, but I'm just going to be thinking about
no,
anything
it's okay.
else.
Okay. Sorry.
Is that motorbike, isn't it? Yeah.
They're leaf blowers, which were made illegal okay. for a short while in Los Angeles. And then
right. What was I saying? Anyway, 1992, he gives an interview where he talks about he's only halfway through his life. I may be coming towards the end of my career, mm. but I'm only halfway through my life, and you know, I don't feel complete, I don't feel whole.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the truth. I don't think he did find the right person. He didn't feel like he was complete because he didn't really have that side of it. His personal life really suffered for his professional life. And I think we all do that sometimes, you know, in our own careers. We all think, you know, I'll settle down after I've made my next movie, or I've got to write my novel before I can have children. All these weird things that people think they have to do. And sadly, I think he was one of those guys. You know, you never think something's going to happen so young.
Well, it has the feel of like a football player, you know, great quarterback retiring.
Yeah.
And he knows the retirement is coming and yeah. there's an yeah. end to it. It doesn't sound...
No sportsman wants to retire. It's the worst yeah. thing. You know, that buzz that you get from training, from going out, from being part of something, And the adrenaline rush you get from driving at 200 miles an hour, you're not going to get that buzz away from the sport. So you always want to delay retiring as long as possible. But when you're in a sport that's so dangerous as Formula One, you know, one freak accident, one thing needs to go wrong, and that's your, you know, you could be fatally injured, or, you know, you could have a terrible career threatening injury. And that's the balance that you have to always have in a dangerous sport like racing.
What's one of the interesting things in the film is how there's, whenever there is an accident, there is this kind of, you see everybody shaken. It's not just Senna. It's, yeah, you know, you see the general sense of, you know, you really get, without anybody actually ever saying it, that could be me.
Yeah, because it can happen anytime.
But
sure.
You really have to not think about it.
Most drivers don't think about it. Yeah. Most drivers kind of don't look, stay in there, you know, trying to stay focused, stay in the car or go away to the pits. Senna was different. In every way, he was always different. He'd be the only guy that would go to the point of the accident. He'd go and see what had happened. He'd look at the drivers on the track. He'd look at the state of the car. He'd look at the track and work out, well, how did that happen? What was it, because it was bumpy? Was it because they caught that curb? Was that curb too tall? Mm-hmm. You know, and then he would try and work it out and understand what had happened, and then he would get back in the car and drive even faster than he did before the accident. You know, and time and time and time again, whenever there was an accident, Senna would go there to see with his own eyes what had happened. And I never saw any other driver do that. Even during the final weekend, yeah, even during Imola, Roland Ratzenberger has a fatal injury, fatal accident on the Saturday, right, and Senna actually took a car and went there to see what had happened and to understand it. And, you know, that no other drivers would do that. There's something particularly about him that he needed to understand. He needed to get as much information as possible.
Besides Senna, is Imola seen as one of the horrifying weekends in the history of racing? Because it sounds like there was, he was not the only story there.
It was a cursed weekend. There was something happened that weekend. You know, there were 7 really bad accidents that weekend. We didn't actually have time to show all of them. 3 major ones, but also there was a start line accident, which we see in the film. People in the crowd were injured. There was another accident in the pit lane. It was just one thing after another after another. And, you know, that's part of the reason why watching it on TV at the time, when Senna had his accident, you knew it was serious, because it just, you just knew, you know, and he would not have made a mistake there. So something terrible had happened. And it's one of the dark periods in the sport. And it's the last time someone has died on a track, a driver has died on a track in the Formula One world. So basically...
Really?
Yeah.
That's the last time somebody died on the track?
Yeah, a driver. So
why do you think that is?
The key thing that happened after Senna's accident is that everything changed. The track safety changed, the cars changed, helmets changed, everything changed. Professor Sid Watkins, his friend, the doctor, he's the guy that took over the sport in terms of improving safety. So everything changed. The other side of it is a lot of luck. You know, an accident could have been 2 weeks ago in Monaco, 3 weeks ago in Monaco. There were 3 really bad accidents. You need a lot of luck. It could happen at any time, because it just needs a freak bit of machinery to go flying in the wrong place.
But not happening for 15 years seems like more than luck. 17 years.
Oh, yeah.
More like
luck. It's kind of the ultimate legacy of Senna, is that everything changed. He spent his life arguing for safety, fighting with the system, and it's really because of his accident that everything changed, which is the ultimate kind of payoff of his life story.
It also seems like the story of his passing has a lot to do with changing in technology and whether we should. You know, it's almost like the creeping terror. Yeah. The whole last section, really, the last half hour of the movie is
the
like a horror movie.
Take
in
over.
A way.
The machines come and take over, for sure. Yeah.
But only for this very short period of time.
No. I mean, they carried on. What happened was the machines took over and they were winning, and he was desperate to get in that machine. But he also said, you know, the sport's changing too much. It's not about the drivers anymore. And then when he does get into the car, the best car, the sport changes the rules, which is constantly happening in Formula One. The rules are always changing. Teams are always pushing the rules. So the guys who run the sport are always changing them to pull them back, or else the cars get faster and faster and faster. So a lot of rules changed in one fell swoop, which made the cars very difficult to drive.
And you don't really address it directly in the movie, or it's not addressed, I don't think, directly in the movie, but do you think he would have won more had he stayed in the car he was in, had he had not made the transition?
Sure. His teammate, I mean, we don't, because the sport for me is over once he has his accident.
Right.
I don't care. You know, they carried on racing. You know, and everyone thinks, the circus just carries on. It's like theatre, isn't it? The show must go on. So they carried on racing while his helicopter's been taken away. Yeah, he would have. I mean, no doubt. He was the best driver, and he had the best car. By the end of that season, that car was the best car. He would have won the title many, many, many times, you know.
So literally, that car was the best car by the end of that season?
His teammate came within a point of winning the title. The other car, the Benetton, was found to have illegal technology on it by the end of the season. He suspected something was not right about that car, And by the end of the season, they found illegal technology on the car. Mm-hmm. The other car, which was driven by Michael Schumacher, was also found to have illegal refueling systems. And Schumacher won the title by crashing into Damon Hill to stop Damon Hill winning the title. So Senna would have won it easily.
So when you started, did your writer, who knew everything and loved everything, have all this kind of laid out, or?
No, he had all the information in his head. It wasn't necessarily on paper.
Was his role, I mean, obviously you guys formed an idea of what everything was.
Yeah.
Because ultimately it's not just naturally there in the footage.
We had to pick and choose. Okay, what are the key races? This one, this one, this one. Okay. And then we start looking at the material and we say, well, actually, this is a really important part of his character. And we've got to get Brazilian. We've got to understand that spirituality is a big part of his life. Okay, these characters are important. And the great thing about Manish is that because he has such a great knowledge, you could show him a frame of anything and say, and he'd know exactly what year it's from and what race. Because often the footage would not tell you what track is that. You know, what year is that? And he would know. He would
so reining him in was a big part of your...
I mean, it was a great kind of perfect kind of relationship. It wasn't like he had a screenplay that we went off and shot. He had all the knowledge. He would tell us something about the script, and then we would work with the material, and it was this good creative tension that you need, you know, with the editors, with the composer, with the sound guys. We were always pushing each other to say, okay, because every day our job would be to go into the edit suite and take out 20 minutes. Let's make it shorter. And then some new material would turn up and the film would get longer again. And then you've got to put this in. This is really important to his character. Okay, but we've got to make it shorter. So we've got to take something else out. And that was the kind of the tension in a way.
Was there a point where you didn't think it was going to work? Ever?
Oh, as a movie, generally? No, I have to say, from very early on, I just thought this could be really special. The challenge was always going to be getting people to go and see it. Getting people who have no interest in sport, who don't know who he is, who don't like, you know, guys driving around in circles at 200 miles an hour looking like a giant cigarette packet. Mm-hmm. Why would I want to go and see that? I don't like sport. Well, actually, what happens is once they see it, they get it. They fall in love with him. There's something about him which transcends the sport. So it was really important to not make the film just for the hardcore petrol guys, you know? And that was the hardest thing, was to get people to go and see it. Once they see it, they get it.
So was it when you did the YouTube version, the 12-minute version, that you kind of knew this is going to...
That's when my first instinct of it could be done without talking heads. Right. But I don't know, I just felt... The more I looked at the footage during that 8-month period, I just thought this is potentially really special. I just thought there's something there. Yeah.
And you had no real interest in racing going into that?
I'm a sport fan. Like, I knew about Senna. I knew about that rivalry with Prost. I was watching Imola live when it happened. Hmm. So I remember very clearly where I was. I was at my parents' house, my dad and my sister
and
watching it with me.
And you were 16 or you were?
I would have been a bit older than that. I was in my low 20s.
Okay. Yeah. And you were paying attention? You weren't.
Yeah, as a sport fan, yeah. Right. But like I said, I wasn't the world's greatest Senna fan. So I was in no way an authority on Formula One. I mean, the people who are into it are so into it. They know every detail. Right. You know, they really study their facts. I'd never read a book. I'd never bought a DVD. I'd never sat there on the internet studying sector times and, you know, oh, look what's happening to the tyres this year. I wasn't that kind of guy.
So when you talk about getting people to see it, is that part of your responsibility as a filmmaker, or is that what comes after
you
got the film?
No, it's my responsibility as a filmmaker, but it's also, you know, it's word of mouth. It's just been the word of mouth in a lot of parts of the world is what has made the film work.
Right.
So it's just somehow the racing fans will know about it. The Senna fans will know about it. The Latin American community will know about it. The Brazilians know who he is. The biggest kind of country, the biggest territory that doesn't know who Senna is the US. Mm-hmm. You know, generally. Everywhere else in the world, they know who this guy is. Because everywhere else in the world, Formula One has been a big part of growing up. It's been a big part of sport, the life. So the challenge here is to get people to see it. But what I find most interesting and exciting is this is the one country where no one knows. If you don't know who he is, you don't know where the story's going.
Right.
So you've got a bigger journey to go on. You don't know the ending.
Yeah.
You know, and I think that potentially makes the film much more powerful.
Why didn't I? I mean, I kind of knew the ending from the beginning, that it was, because it felt inevitable in a way. It was like,
but did anyone tell you literally?
But I didn't know literally how it was
going to happen.
He could have gone off and had a nice life.
Yeah. So that was the thing. You know, also we wanted him to be the narrator, so he's telling the story as much as possible. He's a guy filling in the blanks. So there is, you know, it's only when you get to the ending you realise, oh right, it's like a Sunset Boulevard sort of structure to it. Yeah. So partly I don't want people to know the ending. I don't want to give it away in press.
Right.
I want people to. Hopefully, journalists like it. They tell people to go and see it. But you kind of have to learn on the way.
So is the irony that this the most natural territory for this is Brazil also happens to be one of the worst places for internet piracy and movie piracy? Is there a business to be done down there for this film?
I mean, it's already come out in Brazil. It's already out on Blu-ray and DVD.
Did well
there.
And
It did really well on Blu-ray and DVDs more than cinema. It's a tough country in terms of, São Paulo is like one of the biggest cities in the world. People right. don't travel, you know, it's 5 hours to get from A to B, mm-hmm. and you're not even on the other side of town. So it did better actually in Japan at the cinema than in Brazil, but it's done amazingly well on DVD and Blu-ray in Brazil.
And what do you attribute that to in Japan?
They love him. He's a god there.
He's a god. He's a very popular figure.
Brazil and Japan have a very close relationship. They're very much connected. The largest community of Japanese outside of Japan is in São Paulo. Mm-hmm. And because, like I said, he drove a car with a Honda engine, he was someone that they loved because he made them look good. You know, he drove a Honda car. Japan meant something special to him. So there's always this connection. So they love him. They love him there.
Yeah, a lot of good stories there for him.
Yeah, and all of those championships climaxed in Japan every year. You know, 4 years in a row, the world championships climaxed in Japan.
So as a UK filmmaker, is there a point where you go, fuck United States, it's enough already? I don't have
in
to
what
be
way?
Beholden. Well, it's just, I mean, it seems like, and I look, you know, your earlier feature films and everything, it seems like the United States is a tough market to crack for anybody. I mean, it's a tough market right now, particularly in theatrical. Mm-hmm. Is there a point where you kind of have a working life that really is...
I do. I've made four feature films. No, I mean, I have a fine life in the UK. I live in London. That's where I live. That's where I work. I make my movies. But I wouldn't, you know, say F you to anyone necessarily.
Was the US a specter? I mean, is it something that's always like that? Is that weight of we have to go do a theatrical in the United States? That's the big thing that really matters. Is it not so important anymore?
Well, in this particular case, no. I think this is really exciting. I think it's really exciting because of the way we're doing it. We basically have a small team. We're handling it. The company PDA are doing it, who did a Banksy film last year. And basically, we're all in constant conversation with one another. Mm-hmm. It's a shared responsibility. And I think it's really exciting. You know, what they did with Banksy last year is what we dream about doing this year.
But
you
in
know,
general, started in some, I meant more than...
You can't generalize. It's a big country. It's a lot of different types of cinema. There's different movies, you know, and one hopes to have a long career. So
well, but like you say, you have a career. I mean, obviously, it'd be nice to have... The money that's here.
But I'm a European filmmaker.
Right.
I'm a world cinema filmmaker. Mm-hmm. And so it depends. When I'm making films from around the world, then, you know, the films may be aimed in different territories. If I do a studio film here, then you look into the US. So it just depends on the project. There's no hard and fast rule. And actually, for example, this is a film where we were told, you've got no chance in the US. Never going to be seen, never going to be released. No one knows who he is, no one cares. And it's like, okay, fine. In a way, when someone says that, it's great because that gives you the freedom. So we'll show that you're wrong. You know, we'll take it to Sundance without a penny spent on the film, without any publicity, any PR. I don't even pay my flight. Mm-hmm. You know, we'll go there and we won the World Cinema Audience Prize. So who'd have thought that would happen in the US, you know?
So how was the Sundance experience for you?
It was amazing. It was amazing. It was like restored my faith in, you know, film festivals as well. It was just such a great experience.
Because the audiences?
It's about the
because
movie.
The whole...
The audiences. I don't know. Something about tuxedos in the middle of the day doesn't really work for me. And all that kind of BS that comes with obviously very, very important world festivals.
Right.
Whereas, you know, walking around in wet weather gear is much more natural for me. That's what filmmakers generally are wearing when you're shooting. Every screening's full. People
like
queuing around
England,
the block.
Sunday.
Yeah, you know, I'm very comfortable with drizzle and rain and cold. And it was just great. It was really, there was no baggage. You know, no one knew who this guy was generally. But the fans flew in from Washington, D.C. People drove 900 miles to come and see the film. And then on the other end, we had people from Salt Lake City who'd never heard of the guy, who just had heard there was a good buzz about the film. Mm-hmm. And it packed out every screening. And we finished up, you know, showing at the Eccles Theatre in front of 1,300 people. And a friend of mine was there, because I had flown back by then, and said, you know, there was these middle-aged women discussing, well, what do you think happened in that accident? You know, they were like, they all got so into it. It was great.
When was your experience? Did you go to Japan and...
No, I haven't been to Japan, sadly. I was hoping to. That was one thing I was hoping to do. I didn't get to go to Japan.
Brazil?
Oh, yeah. I've been to Brazil many times. I love Brazil.
So what was the experience like with the movie? Or did you go with the movie yet?
It's very emotional for Brazilians. It's very heavy. Even when he's winning, there are, you know, people are crying. Because it was a tough thing. It's a very, very different experience in Brazil watching it to anywhere else. When people are laughing in other countries, they're crying over there. They love him. He was the guy that gave them hope when Brazil was at its rock bottom. Now, you know, Brazil's coming. You know, it's one of the BRIC countries, one of the most powerful, youngest countries. It's got a World Cup, the Olympics coming this decade. At that time, they were just coming out of a dictatorship. They were in a really bad way. And he was the one guy that took on the Europeans and beat them at their own game, you know. And he would be proud to be Brazilian. He'd be the guy, he'd win a race and would raise the flag. So he means something very, very special there. And so when you show the film, they love him. But every screening I've been to in London or wherever you are in the world, a Brazilian will come to you at the ending, absolutely in floods of tears. just because of the memories that he brings back. Good memories, but also very, very emotional memories.
When there's really nothing like Senna's position in the world in the United States.
You may have issues, but you're not in a military dictatorship, or not that kind anyway. You know, you're basically a rich country. And what we're talking about is if you have a sporting hero coming from a very poor country, really down on, really, really in a bad way, which everyone else is looking down upon, who then goes and beats everyone else. That's something you don't really get that often. You know, there's a guy in India, a cricketer called Sachin Tendulkar. Mm-hmm. India's got 1.2 billion people. Okay, his funeral will be a huge occasion because the guy is loved in a way. Again, you've probably never heard of him, have you?
No. Well, you know, it's funny. I've had the experience with the biggest movie stars from India coming over here to do press for their movie that's getting a tiny little release in the United States.
Yeah.
And they have 7 bodyguards.
Yeah.
And nobody knows who they are.
When I did The Warrior, my actor from The Warrior, Irfan Khan, who's now become kind of well known now.
And a great guy.
Yeah. But he wasn't that well known when I made the film. But we would travel over here and we'd be on the plane. Every air stewardess would be there. Do you need anything, Irfan? It's like the best service I've ever had on the plane, sitting next to him. Mm-hmm. And we walked down a street in London, we walked down a street here in LA, and like, you know, most people wouldn't know who he was. The guys in the shops, the guys driving the cabs, they all knew who he was. And now, you know, he's doing very well for himself. If only I'd kept that 1% of everything that he earned. Yeah.
Well, it's funny, they've been screenings of some Bollywood movies at the American Cinematheque, where, you know, literally 80% of the audience is just there because they're part of American Cinematheque, and then there's like this 20% of hardcore Indian people who are there to see that star, and it's all that drama.
Yeah, but this also kind of comes back to one of your earlier questions. I'm a fan of world cinema, and Hollywood cinema is quite a small part of world cinema. You know, it's not everything. It's not a be-all and end-all, you know. Especially if a lot of it all becomes making franchise movies and comic book films and computer games into movies or fairground rides. That's not really what I'm into, so... Interesting cinema is more what I'm into.
Well, I think my question about fuck United States wasn't so much should you say fuck United States, but was the kind of, you know, my sense is particularly in the independent world that the United States, in particular our independent movement, have kind of slowed down and failed and sputtered out.
It's what inspired me to make movies to begin with, you know, that whole 80s period of Spike Lee and Hal Hartley and, you know, all that indie cinema, all those films coming out in New York, and that's what made me want to make movies. That's what made me think, actually, this is the kind of cinema I'd love to do. But I don't know. Maybe that's changed. Maybe it's kind of gone east.
I think world cinema has kind of replaced American indie at some level. I mean, we have it, obviously. There are people making films, and there's some of them that are good. But I feel like the world cinema has actually become the place we go to, you know, actually see good movies now in a way that we didn't 10 years ago, 15 years ago.
Right. I don't know. LA is different to, I suppose, New York, and it's going to be different.
LA is different than
many parts of the U.S., but yeah. It's you know, for me, from independent American cinema, then Chinese cinema became the most interesting cinema, with Zhang Yimou coming out and a lot of Asian cinema. So that was really that was another big inspiration when I realized, actually, because I was, you know, just coming out of university, all the Hollywood films that I'd go to see with my friends, I just realized these are not engaging with me.
Right.
I'm going to sleep. I know I'm going to pay £8 and I'm going to fall asleep. And the kind of movies I wanted to see, my friends didn't want to see.
Right.
So that's when you have this growing up, when you say, I have to go to the cinema on my own. I don't want to talk for a movie. I don't want to make jokes. I want to actually enjoy something from another part of the world where I don't know where the movie is going to go. And I don't know who the love story is, if there's going to be one at all, you know. So Raise the Red Lantern and Story of Kiju and Cyclo by Tran Un Hung and films like that. They were the movies that made me think, this is the kind of movies I want to do. So that's why my first film was made in Asia and subtitled, because that's the kind of cinema I was watching.
Well, it's interesting because we are the 800-pound gorilla in a way, and yet... At the same time, it's like Europe has the privilege of having all of our crap and all of our good, in a way, and we don't have the privilege of getting the same from England or France or Germany or any of those countries. We get such a narrow selection in this country, and it's kind of the hope I have for the digital world in the future that we will have choice and be able to see French junk and not just, you know, the kind of cream of the crop that with familiar names we know and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I can't answer that. The proof has got to be you've got to go and get people to go and see the movies, isn't it? And if they do well, then people will show them more of them.
So do you have a personal stake in whether something is a television, something seen on Blu-ray or DVD or seen in the theater, in a movie like this particularly?
I make films for the cinema. That's why I go and see movies at the cinema. I fall asleep at home on DVD. I've got 2 young kids. It's not a way to watch a movie. So this film was made for the cinema, and that's how I want people to see it. And eventually, the fans and people will buy it on Blu-ray and DVD, but that comes afterwards for me still. I'm old-fashioned. I'd still be shooting on film and everything if I could. Cutting on film.
Is it even remotely possible?
To do what? To shoot on film?
Shoot and cut on film these days?
You can if you're, you know, Christopher Nolan or Spielberg and people like that are still doing
Spielberg's
it.
Spielberg's doing his first digital, his first digital movie. Tintin is coming out.
Right.
And Michael Caine cut for the first time digitally.
What does his button do?
Yeah. Exactly. He had somebody in with him the whole time and making sure he knew the buttons, but he's figured it out now.
Yeah.
And he's actually cut War Horse with it too, which is
This is my first film where everything is video. Every single frame was video, you know, from U-matic, even the Super 8 and the 16mm footage was transferred onto a tape somewhere along the way. But so we've got everything from Super 8, 16mm, 35mm, but 1-inch U-matic, and bits of it have come from Japan and Brazil. So it's all these different TV formats with different lines and material coming together to try and create a whole, which, funny enough, looks more like film at the ending than most film does now, because it's all so dirty and grainy and scratched, and I didn't want to clean up any frame. I like the way it looks.
Was matching important to you, or are you happy to have it kind of be?
No, I mean, it had to within a scene, you wanted to smooth it out, but it's the technical kind of, you know, what I like about film is it's imperfect. The problem with digital, it looks too clean and perfect. So I like the imperfection. So my film has a lot of this texture, which is what makes you realize this is real. There is no second take. Whatever happened at that moment in time, and we happen to have a camera there. And that's what brings the tension in a way later on in the film, when you realize this is all real, isn't it? It's actually happened. So for me, that's the texture is a part of the story.
What's interesting is watching your film, the footage, particularly in the car, you know, that breaks up, and there's a lot of stuff with breakup, and you're kind of like, you go with it, and it feels completely real.
Yeah.
And nowadays, people are now faking that.
They spend millions
with digital footage.
This. Yeah, exactly. When we were screening the film to working title, and Universal in London, I kept saying, you know, that's don't worry about that. That's what makes you realize they're going really fast. That's what makes it feel visceral. That's what brings the power. And everyone else is faking it, trying to make it look like this, when this is all real. Nothing else looks as fast as him driving a car around Monaco one-handed at 200 miles an hour, you know.
So were they as excited when you delivered the film as when you got them to start?
I mean, you know, when you make a movie and you've been working with people for years, there's always this kind of, we don't know if anyone's going to like this, we like it, but will anyone else? And that's where places like Sundance were so important, because it was an audience that nothing was expected from them. And then in the UK, it's been breaking records. It's, you know, coming up towards nearly £2 million at the cinema after 3 weeks for a documentary. You know, it's been number five, number six in the charts every week. So it's up there. It's number five in all-time documentaries in the
UK. So how do you feel about that?
Good, isn't it? As Senna would say, it's not a bad thing at all, is it?
Yes, but I mean, is it just a warm feeling? Does it say, okay, I'm gonna?
Well, you know, you have an instinct that there's something there, and if the audience are going with it, it's sort of transcending documentary now there, or transcending sports docs there, because it's become. I was doing press for, you know, the most cultural kind of TV and radio shows, as well as the most sporty laddie TV shows, and Top Gear and Jeremy Clarkson like it. They like it, and then on the other end of the spectrum, Radio 3 culture show like it. So we've managed to somehow cross over, which people at Universal have said they've never had any movie that has had this spread of press, positive press.
So did Top Gear make you get in a Formula One car?
Not yet. No, they've had our film like 3 times on their show, and they're out of season right now. But hopefully next season, somebody may well make an appearance on the show.
But not you?
No, probably not me.
So they haven't dragged you onto the show?
I might be the Stig. You don't know. You obviously watched the show.
So they put you on the show. They put the movie on the show without you being on the show.
No, Jeremy Clarkson's been talking it up. That's the main thing. That's what matters. No one knows who I am, but if Jeremy Clarkson says it, then the people who watch it go, "Oh, okay, I might go and see it."
But it seems like such a good time to go on that show. It seems like that would be
you talk to them.
It'd be fun. Well, they seem wacky enough to go do that. They put you in a Formula One car and make you go really fast.
No, a Formula One car, I'd never get it out of first gear. You can't drive one of those things. No one can drive those cars. They're impossible.
So have you ever driven really fast?
No, I drive a Volkswagen, man. I'm very sensible. My wife drives faster than me. She's always having a go. I'm the slow, sensible driver.
So you didn't have to get on the track somewhere to get your brain around the idea of all this?
No, we keep intending to do a kind of rap party whenever we get round to it. We'll be go-karting. That's what we'll do.
So it's about as fast as you want to go.
That's pretty fast, actually.
Yes.
You're sitting on the floor in a tea tray. no, but that's the intention. We'll all go go-karting, and then we'll see.
In a little side city in China once on a trip, they had a go-kart track set up in a former parking garage with some tires.
That would be cool.
And the cars were very, very fast.
Yeah, no, they are.
You really could have died. Yeah, you know, it was really like, serious. As I was, you know, it was 10 years ago or whatever, and I was like, how dumb was I?
That's
I actually thought
stuff.
This was a good idea.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you definitely could get yourself whacked. So you're not into speed, you're just into good movies.
I'm into filmmaking and sport, yeah.
So is the experience so far good since coming to LA? And
yeah, no, it's been great. It's been great. It's always good, isn't it? It's always nice to visit.
Uh-huh.
And then go home again.
And do you have a lot more countries to open still?
Coming up soon is Australia and Canada, as well as US is in August the 12th,
mm-hmm.
as will be Canada. Australia's August the 11th, and then Korea and various other places in the Middle East and Asia. It's already open in Europe, in Spain, Italy, Germany, France, and the UK, obviously. So it's all going strong. And Scandinavia's coming up, so it's doing a bit of a world
tour. So you make all these trips, or some of them?
Some of them, yeah.
And when will it be over for you? When will it feel like it's over for you at some point?
Films are weird. They're never really over. They kind of go off. They move home. Mm-hmm. They move out. But they're still, you know, part of your family. So this one will end, who knows? If it's successful, it goes on for a while longer, we hope, you mm-hmm. know. But I'm only just coming out of doing all the UK press, and now the US is about to kick off because we've got another couple of months of it to go. And then we'll see.
Yeah, no, it's interesting because filmmakers all feel a little differently about it. Some filmmakers really let it go and move along, and they don't want to think about it.
They're the ones who normally have more money and who make more movies than I do.
Is that what it is?
Well, you know, at some point. But if you know, in this particular case, if you don't have a lead actor that's going to do all the press, then you've got to do it. Especially if you're proud of the film, you want to go and get it out there, whatever it takes. And generally what's been happening, wherever myself or the writer, if we go, it sells out. You know, it just helps the film. So you do what you've got to do.
Well, but
it's part of the job of making a movie, I think.
I think so too, but I think it's also I'm more interested in your emotional connection to the material when you kind of let go.
I love
go
the film.
That.
I'm very proud to go and talk about it. Yeah, I'm very happy to.
So you're taking him on a college tour.
Sorry?
You're taking him on a tour of colleges.
If they ask me, then I'll do that. I've done. Yeah, I teach.
But I meant like
I do teach quite a lot,
city.
So I do often take it around to universities and film schools, and I show them, you know, previous work. I show them a scene. I show them particularly the scene in this film when he's arguing with Balest about the cones. Mm-hmm. It's one of my favorite scenes to show people, particularly if they know nothing about sport, have no interest. That's the scene I showed them.
Mm.
Because of the fact that you all get pulled in to this argument about something. And I love the fact that it's character. It's about somebody arguing and making a difference by speaking up. The rules change. Mm-hmm. You know, it becomes safer. During that one scene, he argues for something, and if he had kept his mouth shut, there'd still be tires, and someone would hit them and could have injured themselves. But because he opens his mouth, everything changes. But it's really funny.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very humorous, it's very funny, and the characters of Balest come out, the character of Senna comes out, and then on another aspect, it's just a technical aspect of the cameraman who shot that, for no reason other than professional pride, who knows when to be on a close-up, when to whip pan across, when to be on a reaction shot, when to be on a wide shot, shooting the whole thing against the window, there's one take, they're doing the sound as well, it's mm-hmm. just amazing camera work, technically, and if you know, you gave that scene as a drama to somebody, you'd say, well, where would you put the camera? How many times would you have to move the camera? You go, well, you have to get the single on Senna, the wide shot, then on Balest, and you'd move it then, you get a reaction shot. You'd move the camera maybe 7 or 8 times. And I love the fact someone's done it from one position, yet it feels perfectly done.
And even the dramatic narrative of that scene is unusual.
Yeah.
To have the guy, and we also need to have Robert Duvall to do it, to get away with,
you
know, turning on the dime the way he does, and it leaves the audience considering his motives.
Who, Balest?
Yeah.
Or Senna? Yeah. Well, Balest is outvoted. And by then he chooses
to be outvoted. I mean, he lets himself
He's had a few arguments by then. And, you know, if you know what's going on, he's coming towards the end of his tenure. He's losing his power. So he's got to start listening to Senna now. Because a few races after that, he gets replaced.
Mm.
So there's another subplot, which is that a new guy called Max Mosley comes in and says, okay, now there'll be no more interference, no more corruption. I'm going to be running the sport. And if you know anything about Max Mosley, it gets even, well, it's interesting.
I don't know anything about Max Mosley. So does it get worse, you mean?
Well, you need to look him up, yeah.
Okay, now, so this is your sequel.
I don't know about that.
Max Mosley
is a whole other
Mosley
story. Those that know the sport know that the Max Mosley era was another very complicated era, if you're a McLaren fan.
And then somebody came in and cleaned it up? Guy.
I don't know if that sport can ever be cleaned up. It's the nature of it. It's a business. It's about money. It's about politics with a teeny bit of sport attached.
Well, it's a lot like the movie business in a way. It's like there's so much
money,
money at stake.
Yeah.
And the stakes are so small on some level that it's inevitably a very big head and a very small body.
Yeah. No. Money and politics. It's totally like filmmaking, whether it's Hollywood or anywhere. You know, that's the nature of Formula One particularly.